All righty, guys. Welcome back to the Left of Straight Show Interviews, the premier podcast that shares the stories of our amazing LGBTQ community and, of course, fantastic straight allies, all from entertainment, foodies, books, music, and advocacy. I'm your host, as always, Scott Fullerton, and let's start talking.
Hi, I'm David.
And I'm Alan.
And we're the co-founders
of Fruit Loots.
So the name Fruit Loots came about because Alan and I were thinking about all of the things that inspired us as kids of a particular age. And we thought of, you know, obviously the cereal brands of our childhood, but then the idea that we could be two fruits that have really great loot was kind of like how the name came about. So spin that around however way you want to, but that's how Fruit Loots was born.
When people get a Fruit Loots box, they can really expect a lot of fun, whimsy, and humor built into your design. We really just wanted to capture a sense of nostalgia. Every sleeve design is unique in and of itself, so it truly is one of those like Easter egg cereal box moments that we want everyone to experience when they receive a gift from us.
So there are three easy ways for you to shop Fruit Loots. Number one, go online and shop our pre-picked, curated gift boxes. All you have to do is pick the theme and then add your message and send it on its way. Number two is build your own box. You pick your gifts, you pick your gift wrap, and then you add your own personalized message to the box, and then we send it on its way. And the third easiest way to shop Fruit Loots is just go on and shop for yourself. So by all means, go online, shop for all the really cool things that we have. There's a lot of great gifts on there for everyone and for you.
Well, hey, everyone. I'm thrilled to welcome back my friend Stan Zimmerman to the podcast, a name synonymous with some of television and film's most beloved shows. Stan has carved out a remarkable career as a writer and director, contributing to the rich tapestry of TV classics that have defined generations. A regular guest of the Left of Straight Show interviews, this month's release of his book, The Girls from Golden to Gilmore, shares some stories that even I haven't heard. It's a fantastic read if you haven't got it yet. He also has a brand new play opening up he's directing. Welcome back to the show, Stan Zimmerman. But first, take a look.
Well, thanks again for the ride home, Dirk. I'll see you at Tuesday's jazzercise class.
I'll see you then.
Okay.
Unless I see you before then. I mean, if you wouldn't mind, maybe we could go out.
My Dirk, did I just hear you ask me for a date?
Are you deaf? I heard him from here.
So, Blanche, you think maybe we could have dinner Saturday night?
Well, why don't I just check my date book and I'll let you know.
Sure. I'll call you tomorrow.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Well, isn't this an interesting turn of events? Gosh, I just don't know what I'm going to do. You know, he is a little bit younger than I am. You know what I think? I think I can handle this relationship with Dirk. I'm going out with him Saturday night.
Was there ever any doubt?
Momentarily. This is strictly off the record, but Dirk's nearly 5 years younger than I am.
And what, Blanche? Dog years?
So I didn't know you knew Robert.
I met him at the Life and Death Brigade gathering and the poker game.
Oh, right, right. Well, he must have made quite an impression.
He just asked me out is all.
Sure. He's kind of a jerk.
Excuse me?
Robert, he's kind of a jerk. Have you noticed he's kind of a jerk?
Nope.
Huh. Night's young. Okay, come on.
Where are we going? Logan!
You look great.
Thank you. Logan, stop.
Right, so how you been?
I've been fine.
Good. School's good?
School's hard.
Well, it's supposed to be hard. It's grooming you for life. Making you an upstanding citizen?
God-fearing Christian.
Habitual recycler.
We can't do this here, Logan.
You're right. Let's go.
Go where?
Your place. My place. Let's take a train to New York, spend the night in the plaza.
We can't just leave. We have dates.
I don't like this.
Like what?
You here with Robert.
You're here with Whitney.
I know.
So what's the problem?
The problem is you're here with Robert and it's bothering me, and I don't like that. It's bothering me.
Sorry. Do you want us to leave?
No. I want us to leave. You and me.
I can't do that.
Oh, you want to spend the rest of the night with Robert instead of me?
I came here with Robert.
So dump Robert. I hate Robert.
He's your friend.
So what? I still hate him.
Logan, you're the one who said...
I know what he said.
Okay, then. I have to go. I have a date. Enjoy the rest of the party.
We're back! They're America's favorite family.
Oh, Alice.
but their perfect world is about to change.
I wonder who that could be.
Forever.
I'm looking for Carol Brady. I'm her husband.
Honey, are you all right?
Alice, this is Roy, Mrs. Brady's first husband. He's not dead like we originally thought.
But I did marry Roy first, and I promised to love, honor, and obey him.
And Brady always keeps a promise.
If Roy is really Mom's husband, does that mean
we're not brother and sister?
This summer,
I'm tripping with the Bradys.
Paramount Pictures presents
Marcia, Marcia, Marcia. You have grown up to be so gorgeous.
I know.
And Jan, isn't Marcia gorgeous?
Stan Zimmerman, welcome back, my friend. How are you?
Thank you for having me back. I've missed you.
I always miss you. Unless I talk to you on social media once a month or so, I feel very lonely.
Oh,
I
need my Stan Zimmerman. I'm always there for you. I'm looking at that cash register behind you.
What is that? My cousin and uncle used to own a cash register business and repair business, and so I have a golden cash register behind me on the little bar here.
I have never heard of that as a job, so I may have to steal that for something. So if you see it, you'll know where it came from.
I like it. Oh, that's exciting. Very cool. Well, I'm excited to be able to get to talk to you. Like I said, you have a busy month happening on. Your memoir that we've been talking about for 4 or 5 years is finally being birthed this month.
7, 8 years. Somebody posted a picture. They said, you've been talking about this for like 8 years. And who knows before that. But I think 8 years ago, I started mentioning the title. And then I talked about it at one of the Gilmore Girls fan festivals so that they would be my like accountability coaches, not knowing that every year they would say, when is it coming out? When is it coming out? And during COVID, I really buckled down and drank a lot of espresso. And I, you know what I did was I found a place in my house where I wasn't normally going. And so I made
a
spot.
Yeah.
It is a good for people that procrastinate. Find a spot you never use and kind of make a little, your little sanctuary. And I got my little espresso and had my little, you know, pencils and things and whatnot. And so it was someplace I looked forward to go to every day rather than, oh, that computer and where am I going to do it? Or, you know, unfortunately, I spend a lot of time with my computer in my bed, which I know they tell you not to do, but it's so comfy.
I don't think you're writing when you have your computer in your bed, Stan.
Hey,
that's just
wait a minute.
Wait a second.
Wait a second. Actually, that's the first thing I do is I turn on the computer. I wait till 7 o'clock because a couple of people back east got on my case saying, Stan, do not start work at 6:45 in LA time. I know it's, you know, almost nine, you know, it's after nine here, but just, you know, relax a little bit. So I wait till 7 o'clock and then I'm on it.
I love that. That's hilarious. All right, we're going to have to delete that Pornhub history. That's all there is to it, Stan Zimmerman.
It's embrace your sexuality, whatever it may be.
There you go. Body positivity.
Well,
and sexuality,
I don't know about body
positivity.
That's
my side. For you, your thing's real always.
No, I'm what's called a gay fat. I seriously asked my doctor about Ozempic. When you get to be a certain age, it's like you can't, it's just really hard. I run, I swim, I eat really healthy, I barely drink. You know, in our community, it's really tough. I know you know. And it's funny because, you know, everybody's been posting these 21 pictures, you know, the pictures of them at 21. And I finally succumbed and did it. And people are like, oh my God, you're so cute. You were so cute. I thought I was the ugliest person ever. And
you are such a cute little, I mean, and I hope this doesn't sound xenophobic at all, but you were the cutest little Jewish, you look like a cute little Jewish boy. So you were so cute. I love that picture. I posted mine begrudgingly and said, you know what? Cell phones weren't even around back then. If you're old enough to have a picture on your phone still, because I didn't keep pictures. I mean, you at least kept pictures. I never kept pictures growing.
Taking pictures. I took pictures and I put them, a lot of them in my book, pictures that nobody's ever seen. And at the time, you know, people complain, why are you carrying around the little camera? Because it wasn't like it could just be on your phone. You had to carry a camera separately.
Right.
But I just, for some reason, I grew up with a family that, you know, encouraged taking of pictures. And so I always did. And now I have just pictures of all, and I have photo albums that I still have. But you can tell at a certain point, they just stop. And then it's like all on the phone.
I'm a little jealous of that. We were never, I mean, mom and dad took pictures a bit. They stopped when we all got around high school. So I stopped taking. So like I said, I posted my revenge mean pic of 18 years old the other day when for some reason this poor little white boy had a big fro. I had an afro because I had such curly hair back when I was younger. Did you really?
I had a Jufro. And I had this, I desperately wanted to play Jesus Christ in Godspell. That's how big my hair was. And I actually, in New York, I went to see it off Broadway, I kid you not, dressed with the Superman shirt and and rainbow suspenders. And people thought I was in the play, but in the audience, and I was going to pop out into the play. I'm like, no, I can't sing. I was like one of the first like super fans, like total theater geek. And just, I knew every word of that show. I don't know why that show just, it spoke to me in a weird, not even religious way. It was just the music, and it was so fun and crazy.
It's a beautiful, I love that play too. Yeah. I love most musicals, but that one speaks to me a bit too. That's so funny though. Yeah, if you haven't seen my post yet, when you look at it, I'm in a vest. I think it was my prom picture. I'm in vest and this big curly fro, and it was quite embarrassing. But let's start talking about you and this book, because there's so many questions. I said, I've known you for 8 years now. I've asked a lot of questions. I've heard a lot of stories. There's a lot of stuff in here that I didn't even know.
Like what?
I'm not going to go into too much because I want people to read. I'm not going to talk too much about it because I want people to read the book. But I mean, you really go in depth, and it's such a Stan Zimmerman taste because, like I said, we talk a lot and I try to get gossip and good stuff from you all the time. Mm-hmm. You are the nicest going guy. You never say too much. You won't throw anyone under the bus. You'll be honest. You'll be kind of forthright and everything, but you've never really been the kind of person to kiss and tell. Do you feel that way?
I think I look at it just talking about it from my point of view. So I'm not saying stories to be mean or bitchy. Maybe when I was a little younger, I did stuff like that. I mean, I think there were a few dinner parties that probably got a little drunk or stoned and said some Betty White things that maybe weren't the nicest. But in the book, I talk about that and how I had a very specific view of Betty through the lens of being overly protective of Estelle Getty. And I didn't like the way she... At the time, I thought she was making fun of Estelle because Estelle would forget her lines. We didn't know that Estelle was dealing with dementia at the time because it just wasn't something really talked about. So Betty would go up to the audience and kind of make jokes. I felt at Estelle's expense. But now I see she might have been diverting the attention from Estelle so that Estelle could like go over the lines and she would go over there and kind of entertain the audience. But you see things differently when you're younger, you know, than you do.
I love that. You talk about that in the book. I mean, you said those exact things that you see things from this point of view that you didn't see before. And that's perspective is always a beautiful thing. So, yeah, I love
growing up and being able to always be changing and growing and taking in new information. You know, we don't have to get locked into, you know, that's why I feel like I've been so many different people. I mean, the core has always been. Very sensitive, very heart oriented, very caring about other people, and how other people think and live and the whys of other people. But the growth of turning into a spiritual person and realizing that I didn't have to lose my sarcasm or my wit by also being able to love the world. And so I think, you know, people just want me to be mean. That's not me. But I will be honest. And there were a few things I did write down, put it in. And I was like, no, how is that person going to feel? Is that important enough of it to have in the book? You know, it was good for me to get out some things because, you know, I have been wronged. You know, there's some times.
The log line was funny enough with everything Roseanne.
Yeah.
I mean, that's hilarious.
You know, but I told it like it is with Roseanne. I really respected her point of view. I love that her and Tom Arnold were very supportive of the lesbian kiss episode and would not let that go when it easily could have just disappeared when the network said, we're not letting you write it, then film it, then air it. They stuck with it. What's happened to her now? I wish I could explain that, you know.
Right. Yeah.
Because she was such a champion for the underdog. And now you see her get up and she just is screaming. And I want to say to her, like, how is that helping the world?
Yeah, I don't understand that total 360 from her. I mean, if you can understand going through a lot of things, I don't know if she got bitter after she kind of got tossed a little bit or something, and it just really kind of warped her sense. But she was never that kind of person that she is now. So that's very, she was always knew what she wanted. But
yeah, it's like... and loud about it. But she was also loud if she saw injustice and, you know, and people not being accepted. And yet she just seems so mean to certain people.
Right.
And some of it, it's still the same feeling, which I write about in the book, that when I came on the show, I just wanted to hug her. I thought if I hug, maybe it's my Jesus complex, I don't know. It goes back to the Godspell story. If I thought I hugged her, she'd be okay. And everyone on staff's like, do not touch her. If she sees you, she'll fire you.
Right.
So we had very brief communication. But I would be curious to sit down with her if she, you know, could have a conversation. It would be interesting. And to get her perspective. Like, what was she thinking during then? And I talk about this in the book as well, the week that we had to write her out of an episode because they told us she was getting electric shock. Where was her mind at that year?
I bet she'd even talk to you. I bet she's something she might want to approach again later on, but you never know.
The Tom Arnold of it all, that when it came out that supposedly Tom was having an affair with their development person, like, has anybody really said, like, what were you going through? What were you thinking? So maybe I have to do her
podcast. Bring it out of her.
I have to do her podcast, I guess. Yes.
There you go.
Oh my God.
Another thing I loved about the book, Stan, is like I said, knowing you so well, I just thought you had the most fantastic memory of anyone. I didn't know you kept these journals. I didn't know you were a writer. And finding the journals in the book is an amazing piece of the history that goes with it. Was there anything that sparked in the journals that was specifically significant for you when you read them again that you might have forgotten?
I guess recurring themes that being scared on the job so much. Because that was one of the first things I did was I sat down and I just pulled everything from the journals, which I've been keeping since college. Entries about the different shows and just that fear we always had of like, are we going to be asked back, keeping quiet about being gay on shows, just not respected as writers. I mean, that was a constant.
Right.
And that, you know, shows would end, even successful shows, jobs would end. How do you pick yourself up again? How do you keep going? How do you have this belief? Like, wow, like that was, and someone else acknowledged that too, saying they were shocked that, especially like on Golden Girls, how do you be your best self and write when you're not allowed to show who you really are?
And right.
I don't know how we did that. That's what kind of amazed me, how we could be so vulnerable and open when we were really told to be closed and not share who we are, our gay side anyway.
Well, I think the key word in there is we. I mean, you had Jim with you the entire... I think if you were by yourself, it would have been an entirely different experience if you're going through that.
I would not have done it on my own. I always thought I needed somebody else. And thank God I really had him through my entire, you know, business career and most of my life, of somebody to just like look at and go like, do you believe what the fuck just happened? Or like, how do we get out of it? And we always could balance each other out that... If one person kind of was going off the rails, we go, calm down. Like, we got this. Let's figure it out. I'm so lucky to have him in my life. I just, you know, and even though I talk about that in the book and I wondered if I should do that. You know, there were some times when I didn't know if our careers would continue together. And I thought we were on this trajectory. And then he had a period where he just he was tired of the hours of sitcoms and didn't really want to do it. I'm like, wait a minute, we're going here. You can't just stop. You know, and it's funny, that's when I had to again reinvent myself when I got back into theater. And that changed my whole life in teaching. And I loved all of that. And you know, now he's, you know, loving the whole kind of trajectory that we have now with Silver Foxes and doing that play. And he's like, let's do more of that. So we're actually thinking of doing a sequel to it. And the theater where we world premiered it last year with Michael Urie directing it, the Uptown Players in Dallas, keeps saying, we want a sequel, we want a sequel, and put both of them in rep. How cool would that be?
Oh, that'd be amazing. Oh my goodness.
I love you down to your bones, naked and afraid. They don't know.
So we're gonna try our friend actually made this, so yay gay people.
It's vodka wow, soda.
It's vodka soda's different flavors. Look mm-hmm. how cute this packaging is. Oh my god, the cans are so cute.
So cute.
Oh my god, watermelon!
Okay,
oh my god,
watermelon.
Oh shit. Cheers.
I love that. Well, going across and going through your notes, and you have talk so great about all these fantastic women in your life. Was there anyone you came across that you didn't really decide to write about? Anyone that had a significant impact, either personal or professional? You don't have to name a name, but someone that didn't make the book just because it was so personal to you of what they might have done for you, or
No, there were some personal anecdotes that I felt it would hurt the person if they read it. And at some point, maybe when you're in Palm Springs with a cocktail, I'll tell you. something different to look forward to, right?
Exactly, right.
Some juicy details that you go, no, I don't think, you know. Because the book will live on after me and during me. So I wanted it to feel like people were sitting down with me with a drink, either, you know, a vodka or a rosé or coffee, and just, you know, shooting the shit. And that's kind of just rolls off my tongue. And finding that voice to be able to write like I'm talking was really something new for me.
Well, it came off exactly like that, though. It was very conversational, very like we're sitting across from each other, which I like. I've talked to quite a few people about it as it's been coming over the years. I've talked to people since we're all getting ready for it to see it, and then I got to tell them I got to read it already.
Yeah,
but so that was kind of exciting.
Very jealous of you, yes.
They're a little jealous of me, but it was like they want more, though, because it's like this was a great ensemble of these women you talk to. There's nothing about Stan's personal life. There's nothing about some behind this. There's not too much about they want to know the dirt. They want to know the Stan Zimmerman dirt.
Well, I do a little bit of my gay awakening in New York, and one of the first boyfriends that I had that took me to Studio 54. I thought about not having that in there because it didn't really have anything to do with, you know, the girls. I tried to stay on theme with it. I could have gotten heavily into, you know, a really bad breakup that I had that was really hard to find my footing again after that, you know, for the first time really telling someone that you love them and thinking they were the ones, and I guess they didn't feel the same way.
I think that's going to come, though, because I think this is your, we all know you have such a big Hollywood circle of friends and fans, and you have a bunch of us that are friends and fans, but I think this is really going to open up to the masses. I think so many people are going to love this book that they're going to want to know all about Stan Zimmerman, the person, next.
They're
so you're going to be writing again.
Really? They're going to care about that?
I think so. I think so.
I mean, maybe if I get into, like, how do you pick yourself up? You know, I think I first was like, I'm never writing another book. I thought about doing the men in my life, which again, that could incorporate the men that I've dated and could get into the personal stuff. But, you know, when I went through the bad breakup, I didn't do a cocooning thing. I didn't really, I just threw myself right out there. I was speed dating. I mean, I did every kind of, any kind of dating. I just didn't want to sit home and feel sorry for myself, you know? And I often wonder, would it have been better to, was I not healed enough to put myself back out there in the world? I don't know. I mean, I did what I thought was right at the time.
I think this is a great book. I think it, you've touched on so many touchstones, but like you said, the men in your life, I went to Columbus Comic Con a month and a half ago, said hi to Barry Bostwick for you. And he gushed for like 10 minutes about you. We talked for 10 minutes. I got to speak to Barry Bostwick for 10 minutes because I mentioned Stan Zimmerman's name.
And
it was
welcome.
Amazing.
Yes. He was a sweetheart. We got to make a wonderful web series called Skirt Chasers. And again, that's thematic in my book about, we wrote this pilot on spec and everybody loved the premise. It's about a lesbian and her father, and they both cheated on women, but they were estranged and they needed to work out their interpersonal relationship before moving on. People love the concept. They never heard of it, love the writing, but they would say, we have our one lesbian show for the year. And I felt bad that I really thought that it was going to go somewhere because we had Barry Bostwick, we had Meredith Baxter, we had Elizabeth Keener. We had Leah Delaria offered to record the theme song. She recorded a cover of I'm a Girl Watcher, you know, that song,
right.
That 60s song. It was such an amazing group. I still have high hopes. I think it's a strong concept. But again, the world was saying, sorry, you can't do this on network television. So what am I going to do? I have to figure out another way to get that concept out there.
I love that. I mean, you did some great series for Tello, and I loved all those. I'd like to hear more about those down the line in another book. I had a question from someone that I kind of thought was interesting. You've done all this writing since. You talk about the history and how starting out. How has television changed for your writing from back in the Golden Girls to now, if you want to write for a series today? What's the big difference in writing these days?
I think the difference is there's more opportunity. When I started out, I mean, really there was four networks. Fox was just starting out. So think about that. That was new and exciting, you know, Married with Children and very different and shocking. And then, you know, cable was, and HBO and Showtime were only movies. It was before they even started making movies or making series. And then that opened doors, you know, when you think of Sex and the City. There's just more opportunities. And you can also write something and film it yourself. You know, we now have phones that are beautiful. You can edit stuff. You can make whatever content, whether it's something on TikTok or some longer form or short film. You're not having to wait for somebody else to give you the green light. Obviously, if you want to play in a bigger, you know, in a bigger world like studios and streaming companies, yes, you still need that. And those worlds, unfortunately, I think have not changed all that much. we just wrote a Lifetime Christmas movie last year, called Ladies of the 80s, with Donna Mills and Nicholas Sheridan and Linda Gray and Morgan Fairchild and Lonnie Anderson. It was fantastic. Alec Mappa. We ran into so much network interference. It was like, really? After all this time, they were just complaining about, I don't know, we had a young love story. I named her after my niece, Nell.
Right.
Nell, why do you have to use that name? And it's so old fashioned and nobody, blah, 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 blah. Who cares? Who cares? If I want to use the name, let me use the name. There's all and we were under a gun because we had to write it before the writer's strike.
I remember.
We have a limited amount of time. That's the note you pick. I was always taught, pick your battles. That, if I was an executive, would not have been one of the battles. And they eventually let it go because I was just like, do you hear yourself? I called them on it. Because at that point, I think the older you get, you just go like, what the fuck? I said to Jim, my writing partner, this is the last job we do. I don't fucking care anymore. Like, we have done so much. I don't care. I want to do a good job. I want it to be funny. Lifetime oh my God, there's all these jokes. I'm like, this doesn't sound like our Christmas movies. Yes, I know. But you've hired us and you've hired these five actresses. People want it to be funny and campy and bitchy and all that delicious stuff. That's the movie you have. Don't run away from it. Embrace it.
The trouble is, I think in these days, it's like they can't see the forest or the trees. And it used to be 1 to 5 producers or executive producers. And now you have 8,000 people that want to have their input into things, right? It's not like it was where you have just a small group of people getting films made. Now you got everyone's got a co-executive producer spot or something like this on it, where everybody needs to get their 5 seconds of fame by putting in their 2 cents, smart or not, right?
I just heard something that Issa Rae was talking about, all the interference that even someone at her level is experiencing and getting projects done. And you're like, have the networks and studios and streaming companies not learned? Hire people you believe in their vision and then just say go. I mean, maybe you give them a little like, oh, we need this and that. And network television is a little different because it is so sponsor driven. So if they don't have the sponsors, they don't have the shows. But something like a streaming company, just hire the person, and then if you don't like what comes back, you know what? You don't work with them ever again. You do, and it's always the original voices that really end up breaking out. When you think of Amy Sherman-Palladino and the show she did, you know, with the Gilmore Girls, or even Maisel, just sound unique. Even Norman Lear at his time. People, when all the family started, they were like, what the hell is this? And you can't have a lead be like that. And he's so grumpy and politically incorrect before that term was even a term. But you know what? It was a great point of view.
It
gave such a great way to talk about all of that and then have his son and Gloria and all of that. It was so smartly constructed. But you don't see a lot of
that. I think that's the point, is people were actually like that. And if they started seeing themselves and their neighbors and their grandfathers and stuff on TV, people are saying, this hasn't been done. It's like everyone's seeing it in their family all the time or in their neighborhood. So, yeah, I think it was ahead of its time.
Well, I was watching little clip of some new show. Don't make me say which show it is. A preview. And I've seen it because it keeps popping up. I'm going, they think this is funny? There's not funny at all. And that they picked their best jokes for the little, you know, clip to draw you in. And it was with really good actors and actors that have been on hit sitcoms. And I'm just watching it thinking, eesh, you know, no wonder people are turning away from multicam shows because of, maybe it's a better show and I have to give it a little more chance, but.
It's been a little different for me because, you know, I've always been into the personalities of the people more than the projects or everything. I like talking about their projects, but I like the people a little bit more. And I got invited into this Galeca Association last year, the Gay and Lesbian Entertainment Critics Association. So now I'm getting all these screeners for everything and seeing all these things ahead of time. And you're right. Some of these things are like, I can't believe these things are being made with some of these fantastic people. And it's just, it's I don't understand some of it. I mean, a lot of them are hits, but some of them are like way off course.
But you know what? We don't watch it, and hopefully they'll go away.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, last thing I want to talk about, and I want to get into two other points before we start going into the play, because you're doing a fantastic play in Palm Springs. But I want to talk about the change. I mean, this is a very funny book. It's very juicy. It's very conversational, but also it goes poignant. I mean, you've really started changing. You've always had your stuff over the time about your suicide awareness and everything. And now you did Anne Frank. So you really have this poignancy that's really kind of come in the last 10 years or so. Talk about the importance of you bringing these more serious side to the forefront.
Well, when you really look at even episodes of Golden Girls, we were doing, you know, adult education was about sexual harassment way before people talked about it. So I've always been sensitive to other people's stories or plights or injustice. Years ago, when Jim and I were, it is now a Sony lot in Culver City, but it was Lorimar owned the lot. And we found out that we were in the Robert Taylor building. And Jim came to work and said, did you know that Robert Taylor named names during the McCarthy trials? And I was like, I don't really know that much about the McCarthy trials. And I started doing some investigating. I'm going, that doesn't seem right. This building housed writers and directors that Robert Taylor, by him naming names, they lost their livelihood. They lost everything, everything.
Right.
So we did a little petition of all the writers in the building, the lot, and we got the name changed. And then the right wing went nuts, and Pat Buchanan and Nancy Reagan got involved. And that was my first taste of like, oh, wow. Like, but if you believe in something, fight for it if you see injustice. And I didn't realize till Norman Lear recently passed what an influence growing up watching his shows had on me. And I think that's where I got the idea that you can marry popular entertainment and also speak about the truths in the world. And as difficult as some of the subjects are. And that's, I think, why I feel so much when I see something like children's separation at the borders during the last administration, or when my friend died by suicide and feeling totally helpless. And I can't just sit back. It's like, what can I do? How can I use my craft? And that is why it makes me feel active rather than, you know, otherwise I would think I would just get under the covers and you wouldn't see me anymore. And I would just kind of, you know, turn inward. But I'm like, no, get up, do something. You were born with something, some gift to create and have a vision. And that's when these things just came to me, like just the idea of staging Anne Frank that way, the idea of taking real suicide notes and putting it in a play that now I can perform anywhere within a day because it only takes people reading the scripts on stools and music stands. I just came back from Austin where I did it, and it was amazing to have that experience. And we're about to do a test project of the suicide note play with high schools in the San Fernando Valley. And if that goes well, we plan to take it to a different school at least once a month. And that program could be replicated all over the United States. Think of the lives we could save and get kids talking about it and growing up not having shame around how you feel the way I did growing up.
I just can't imagine the power that would bring to a high school auditorium. Oh, my goodness. I love that.
So I'm very, very excited about that. Is that anything in the realm of your question?
No, that was exactly what I wanted to hear. I think I love your words and you use them to such great effect. And it's even been more so throughout the years. So I love that. I want to finish up. I mean, we talk about your book is called The Girls from Golden to Gilmore, but there's three very special girls. Your tribute to, you know, I'm a mama's boy, taking care of my mom here in Northeast Ohio. The chapter devoted to your mother, oh my goodness, at the end, it leaves you with that melancholy kind of this amazing career, everything you've had, but the love that was underneath it all. So talk about those three important girls, your sister, your mom, and your grandmother.
They were very important to me, and I love that they were vocal, and I got to see very, very intelligent women talking and feeling and expressing their emotions. And I think that's where I learned to be able to write them and listen to them. As a man, not explain it to them, but take it in and grow from it. But my mother was especially my biggest cheerleader. And, you know, when I started the book, she was alive. I was hoping she'd get to see the day when it would be out. But then that became the end of my book, was her death in the 13 days, probably the most difficult days of my life, of between her stroke and the hospital and hospice. And I've learned so much just since the book about how we celebrate birth, but we don't celebrate death and the way out. And I, you know, when she started to have dementia, you know, even I heard Demi Moore talk about it, you know, within the context of Bruce Willis and saying, you have to meet them where they are today, not what you want them to be. And, you know, I really attempted to do that when I would visit her at least, you know, at least once a week. And I felt it was such a privilege that I got to spend, you know, a couple hours just having these amazing conversations. You know, she knew who I was, and we got to talk about the past and so many great things. But she never would have wanted to be in any diminished capacity. And we talked about that a lot. She kept saying, right, you know, if I ever got like that, just push me over the edge of a cliff. And I'm like, Mom, I can't do that. That would be illegal. Do it. So I don't think she would have wanted to be like that. And I actually talk to her now more than ever. A former student did a reading, and she was talking to me through the moon. She says, your mom loves you to the moon and back. And I looked out my window, and there was a full moon staring at me. So now wherever I go, I suddenly see this moon, and I really feel she's there. She's probably the best agent I've ever had. I've never worked so much since her passing. I think she's up there making all these connections.
Probably.
Yes, she doesn't take 10%, so that's the good part. I also think of it, no matter where I go in the world, and I've been traveling a lot with my work lately, as you know, she has the best seat up there. And
there you go.
Yeah. So I well dedicate said. That to her.
Well, I love it. I thought it was such a moving chapter, and you know how I feel about my mom. She just turned 85 last Wednesday, and she's kicking the best she can. So
I'm
cherishing every moment, and I definitely will. And that last chapter just made me go a little bit deeper into it. So I appreciate that a lot. The book's called The Girls from Golden to Gilmore, and it's out right before Valentine's Day. So I'm excited for you guys to be able to go see that. Let's get into play, though. I mean, I think you really started coming to your own in Fringe Festival, I think. That's when you really were going boom, boom, boom with getting some of these plays done. And now we're at our good friend Terry Ray's new playhouse, The Bent, at the Palm Springs Cultural Center. Talk about how did this come to you, the new century?
Well, I've been a huge fan of Paul Rudnick for years. He wrote In and Out, Adam's Family Values, the play Jeffrey, The Most Fabulous Story Ever Told. I read this play and I was like, I have to do this somewhere. I did a little reading in my living room with Mindy Sterling, of course, and Teresa Ganzel. And we talked about actually doing it at the Fringe Festival one year, and we couldn't get the rights or something happened. So I know Terry a little bit, but I know his partner, Steven, who's his business partner at The Bent. And he was like, you should come guest direct. And they offered me one play, and I said, I'll do it, but maybe look at this other one. And they read it, and they're like, no, we have to do this one. And I've been able to work with amazing local Palm Springs talent. And there's such a burgeoning theatrical scene down here. I'm loving being a part of it. I have been down here for many, many weeks, kind of seeing if it's a place that I could eventually live. And I have to tell you, I almost don't want to go back to LA. It is, the mountains are so gorgeous and so calming. And you know, that's why you're going to be here soon. It's really a special place. So I, for the first time, can actually see myself down here. But we open on the 8th and playing only two weekends through the 18th. But his play is so smart and so, of course, freaking funny, but also, and I don't know if it's just me, but I'm finding the heart in it. There are some moments that I think people are just going to tear up, especially in this community of a lot of gay men down here, because he talks about AIDS, he talks about the effect of 9/11, and something you'll relate to, I wish you could see it, through the points of view of two moms. One mom's son died of AIDS, and another one, she is the Purple Heart in motherhood. She's got a lesbian daughter, a gay son who's into leather. I mean, she has every part of the our beautiful rainbow. And he writes so smart. And Terry Ray plays the gayest man ever. And so it's a stretch for him to do that. But it's outrageous writing, but it's beautifully done. And there's a little male frontal nudity just for
those. There you go.
For those there in the audience. Yeah, there's your ticket.
I wish I could get down there for it, but it looks amazing. The artwork that you guys have put out, I don't know who's doing your artwork, but that is amazing. And like you said, I think Terry Ray is responsible for bringing a huge resurgence in Palm Springs theater. I mean, there's always been great film festivals. They talk about it a lot. There's lots of great movies there and movie festivals. But as far as theater goes, Terry started teaching down there, and then he co-started The Bent with Michael, like you say. You would be such a welcome addition down there. I think you guys would take that town by storm. Like you said, I fell in love with it my first road trip. Being from Southern California, my last remembrance of Palm Springs was going there on spring break, right? When it's just wild, crazy. Right? I went as a high schooler and a college kid.
Oh, my God.
And then I go back in my late 40s and then maybe early 50s. I don't want to talk about it. But then I find this entire new LGBTQ community that I didn't know existed in the same way. I fell in love with it. The views, the mountains. We'll have to get an apartment. I looked in the one senior living place there. Yeah. I thought, oh, 55 up. They want like a lot for a month.
Play the living out place?
Yes.
Yes. I drove by there and yeah, I looked into that too. That could be something, you know, down the road.
It's gorgeous, but it's like $8,000 a month or something,
I
think.
Yeah, but you get food and you get food and everything. And they have the wonderful restaurant there, which I'd like to try when I have a night off from rehearsal.
I want to try that too. I wanted her on the show. I love the Top Chef and the chef competitions, mm-hmm. and she's always been such a great competitor and so good. So yeah, I like her a lot.
Well, maybe when you're down here, we'll have a meal there.
Yeah, we'll have dinner there for sure.
Okay.
I'm going to try to reach out to be a sponsor of the road trip. We'll see. The guy that owns that resort is a real estate developer and is gay. The one that manages a partner is straight. So I'm gonna reach out and we'll see what happens. If they want to do a sponsor while I'm down there.
Okay.
No matter what, I'll eat at that restaurant.
Yeah,
it's
called
Alice
B, and it's right. It's I mean, I remember all the restaurants in LA and the city and Border
exactly.
Grill. I mean, I've had so many meals at those places, and looking forward to help, you know, being with them down here.
There you go. Well, Big Gay Road Trip will be there July 9th through August 9th. You're going to be out in a little bit of France, though, beforehand, before you're able to come down. Remind everyone about that. You had this great experience last year we talked about. Remind everyone what that's all about.
Yes, I was asked to mentor writers at a castle, 14th century castle, in the countryside of France for 3 weeks last year. They invited me back this July. It's called Rockaberry Writers Retreat, and it is very intense and beautiful, but I have to drink wine and eat beautiful French food every night. Isn't that awful? Yeah, it's a
you
terrible
poor thing.
It's a
How
terrible
do you
job. I don't know. I was thrilled when they asked me back because when I teach, I give like 1,000%. I give my everything. So after the sessions, I'm so drained. I literally lie down in my beautiful four-poster. But here is the interesting thing. I get to the castle and there's like, oh, we picked a special room for you. And on the door, it said Queen Mom, which we used to call my mother. And supposedly the Queen Mom stayed in that room, the real Queen Mom of England.
Oh my goodness. That's exciting.
I know. So that was intense. So I really felt my mother there watching over me, and she would have loved it, loved every second of it.
I bet. Oh my gosh. Well, that's amazing. I'm sad that I know that you're not going to be the first half, but it may give me an excuse to sneak in and tear out some of that rug that I want in your carpeting to
okay.
hang on my wall. We'll see yeah. what happens
okay.
there. Stan Zimmerman, remind everyone, you have a great website that shows a lot of these things. Give them the title of your book and where they can find you on social, my friend.
Find me on social, ZimmermanStan.com. I just did a refresh on it. I think it looks adorable and cute and very easy to get around on it. Yeah, so follow me there and find me everywhere and let me know what you're doing. And I'm appearing in many places around the country. But right now I'm going to be out there talking about my new book, The Girls from Golden to Gilmore.
There you go, guys. Check that out. It comes out on the 13th. This the play, The New Century, is going to debut the night after this airs. We're actually filming this a week ahead of time. But 9th through the 18th, I believe, Thursdays through Sundays for 2 weeks. Be sure to check out the play. We appreciate
you
coming
out. Go to thebent.org if you want tickets.
There you go. I love that. Stan Zimmerman, you know I love you. Thanks so much. I appreciate you, my friend.
Bye.
Stay on the line for me, guys. We're going to have another 5 questions with Stan because, you know, I like to have a little fun with my friends here. We appreciate you coming in every week here to the Left of Straight podcast. And Left of Straight interviews are so lucky to have people like Stan Zimmerman. Have a great week, everyone. We'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to the Left of Straight show. Be sure to subscribe on your favorite podcast distributor and please give us a 5-star rating so more listeners can find us. You can follow us on social media and be sure to check out our website, www.leftofstraightradio.com, for contests and other news and information. See you next week.